Okay, so it's time to start. So you have your test on Wednesday. Anything you want to, any question you want to ask? So I guess all of you are well prepared, or will be well prepared.
Dr. Batra?
Yes?
Could you go over the end of the homework assignment that was due today and go into how you go from indicial notation to matrix notation?
Okay. So the homework assignment that's due today says write, well, one part says write . We don't need to worry about two. Write this in the matrix notation. So the first, if you look at dij dot dxi dxj, we can write that as dxi dij dot dxj. That's the first term, right? So that one, if you look at these two terms, that's matrix multiplication. That's dxj, dij is a second order, or a 3x3 matrix, and this one is a vector, so it's a column matrix. So we can write that as d operating upon dx, and that's the ith component of that. Does it make sense? Because j is sum. So now this is an inner product, because you have I and I, and both are vectors. So one of them should be a column matrix, and the other one should be a row matrix. So we can write this as dx1, dx2, dx3, so that's a row matrix. The next one is going to be a column matrix. So it's d dot dx1, one component, d dot dx, second component, d dot dx, third component. Does it make sense? And if you multiply these now matrix, you will get the inner product. Then we can write dx1, dx2, dx3, and this one is this D matrix, which is like D11, D12, D13, D21, D22, D dot matrix, and this dx1. dx2, dx3. So if you multiply this square matrix by this column matrix, you will get a column matrix. So the next thing is writing D dot as D11, D12, D13, D21, D22, D23, and so on. Does it make sense? Was it Carrie who asked this question?
It was Catherine.
Okay, Catherine, does it make sense?
It does, but I was unsure of the third term where the K's
I'm going
are
to
not
go there now.
Okay,
so I'm going to go there now. So that takes care of the first term. Now if we look at this one, LKI DKJ, so that's really to multiply them, K the repeated index has to be next to each other. So we can write LKI DKJ. Now to get this K next to each other, I say it's L transpose. That will give me IK. See, L transpose IK is the same thing as LKI. And then the next is DKJ. Is this step clear? And then we have L transpose D IJ. And the rest is the same because all you would do is replace D dot by L transpose D. Because we did this DXI DIJ dot DXJ. So we arrived at this step. Now to evaluate this term, DXI, LKI, DKJ, DXJ, all you do is replace this D dot by L transpose D. Is it okay? Or it doesn't make sense? Yes?
I guess that part makes sense, but I have another question relating to this whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so obviously with matrices, you can't switch which one is multiplied first, but when you're using the other notation, can you do that? Like, can you switch L and D?
If you are using indices, you can write this as DKJ LKI. That's okay.
So as long as when you put a matrix in notation, you match up the K's, then it should be...
So K's have to be next to each other to multiply. You can't have, like, the summed index has to be next to each other for the matrix multiplication. Yes.
So for the third one, you switch them, correct? The L and the D?
The third one, you first, since D is symmetric, so you can write DIK as same thing as DKI. D is symmetric, right? So on D, you can interchange indices.
Well, you take both the transpose.
Then this becomes transpose of that. See, this thing is transpose of that. Because you are interchanging I and J. And that should be the case because D dot is symmetric. Only the symmetric part of this really matters because DXI and DXJ, they are symmetric in I and J. Okay? Yes?
For the third one, why do we need to do that? Because I needs to be the first term, so it's going to be D multiplied by L.
Yes.
We do not.
Oh, yeah, you can, sorry. You are right. Yeah. You are right. You can say it's D multiplied with L. Yes. You are right. You can say this thing, yeah, she had a better answer than I had. So it's LKI, DIK is the same thing as DIK. Oh, there is a J somewhere, yeah, J. LKJ, which is DLIJ. Yes, that's true. Any other question or comment you have about anything we have covered so far? Remember, your task is going to be on the material we will cover by 12:15 today, or 12:05 today. So if you want to ask anything else, it's a fair game. So either you are shy or you have learned everything, one of the two. Okay, so what we were doing last time was that we were given E11. Actually, we said we will have Josh Strenzler do the experiments, but today we have Fred also here. So Fred Cook can do the experiments. So let's assume Fred is doing the experiments today. And he can measure all six components of strain, whereas Josh was measuring only three components of strain. So Josh measured E11, E22, and E12. And we found these as functions of like X1 and X2. But today, Fred Cook has a better measuring instruments, we are assuming, and we can find all six components of strain. So these are functions of X1, X2, and X3. So these are functions of X1, X2, X3. Okay. Now remember, we have strain gauges. In this case, we have strain gauges in the interior of the body too. Somehow, as soon as I say we have strain gauges in the interior of the body, then we have to have, think of this, that we have wireless instruments. So strain gauges can transmit the data without connecting wires to them. Imagination, okay. In real life, you cannot do it. But imagine that our strain gauges are wireless. And we have embedded them in the body, and we apply loads. They give us data. So we have data at several points, and we have fitted smooth curves to them and gotten strains, all six components of strains, as functions of X1, X2, and X3. So the question is our data correct? Is the data correct? How do we check if the data is correct or not? So we know that the definition of small strains, and here we are assuming we are in small strains, and the same thing what we are doing now will apply to those of you who work in fluid mechanics. You can think of measuring velocity field at several points in the wind tunnel, and you have fitted not only velocity field, but actually the strain rate field, not velocity field. If you measure velocity field, then there is nothing for me to say. Okay. So let's assume that you measure strain rate field. So the analog of strain in small deformation solid mechanics problem is the strain rate in the fluid mechanics problem. The analog of displacement is velocity in the fluid mechanics problem. So we have UA comma B plus UB comma A. So how many components of strain do we have? Sorry, how many components of displacement do we have? For a three-dimensional body, how many components of displacement do we have? Am I talking Greek or English? Is the question making any sense to you? So how many components of displacement does a particle have? Yeah, of course you know.
It's six. It's X, Y, Z, and then the rotations at the point.
No, you goofed. You goofed. Have we talked about rotations in the class? See, we have been saying a particle has 3 degrees of freedom. Displacement in the X direction, displacement in the Y direction, displacement in the Z direction. These are particles. Particles. These are not rigid bodies. Okay? So these particles, all we are considering in continuum mechanics is the translational degrees of freedom of these particles. If you wish to study rotations as well, then we are no longer in classical continuum mechanics. We are in a little bit advanced continuum mechanics. It's possible. It's possible. But that's not what we will be studying in this course. Because if you consider, if you assume that each particle has not only three translational degrees of freedom, but three rotational degrees of freedom also, then the stress tensor you learned in your deforms class, you said sigma xy was equal to sigma yx, is no longer valid. Okay? And then you learned in your deforms class as well as fluid mechanics class that sigma xy equals sigma yx, sigma xz equals sigma zx, the stress tensor is symmetric. That will not be valid if each particle has rotational as well as translational degrees of freedom. That is valid only if a particle has translational degrees of freedom. So the inertia, the rotary inertia of these particles is basically zero. Or we are neglecting it. We are not considering it. So we have three components of displacement, U1, U2, U3. And we have six equations. E symmetric, so we have E11, E12, E13, E22, E23, and E33. So we have six equations for three unknowns. Last time, towards the end of the period, we had three equations for two unknowns. So we had E11, E22, and E12 was given as a function of X1 and X2. And we had, so what did we do? So we had three equations for two unknowns. So what did we come up with? This you forgot. So we said we derived one equation and called it a compatibility condition that must be satisfied for us to be able to integrate those three equations. So let me review. So what we said was that this one is given to be a function of x1 and x2. We are in a plane. That's a Josh Strangler's experiments. We will come to Fred's experiments in a little while then. So E22 is delta U2 over delta X2, and that's just, so G is a function of X1 and X2, and we have E12, which I'm going to write twice of E12, is delta U1 over delta X2 plus delta U2 over delta X1, and that's H. So we have three equations for two unknowns, U1 and U2. You cannot solve them or you cannot integrate them till you have one compatibility condition. You have to satisfy one equation, one relation among F, G, and H before you can integrate these three equations for two unknowns. Otherwise, you will not get a unique answer. You may not get an answer. And to see that equation, if you take the third one, you say, and differentiate it with respect to x1 and x2 square, sorry, with respect to x1 and x2, differentiate this equation with respect to x1, x2. So it should be 3 here, plus delta cube u2, delta x1 square, delta x2. Differentiate both sides with respect to x1 and x2. Then delta u1 over delta, so we can write this thing as the partial derivatives commute. So the partial derivatives commute. So we can write this equation as this one. And now we get delta square over delta x2 square. Delta u1 over delta x1 is f. And this is g. So this is the equation that f, g, and h must satisfy for us to be able to find u1 and u2 from three equations. Okay? So this is called compatibility condition. So one, you can think of as we have three equations and two unknowns. So 3 minus 2 equal to 1 is the compatibility condition. So we need one compatibility condition among f, g, and h before we can integrate these three equations for two unknowns. Okay? Now, if we go further, so now we have six equations. Because even all six components of strains are known as a function of big X1, big X2, and big X3. And we have only three unknowns. So how many compatibility conditions will we need? Three. Six minus three. So we will need three conditions. And these are called, so we need three compatibility conditions. Or you can say these are three integrability conditions. In order for us to be able to integrate these six equations, A and B go from 1 to 3, but it's symmetric in A and B. So that's why there are six rather than nine. So in order for us to be able to integrate these six equations, we need three compatibility conditions. Okay? Now the question is, how do we find it? In this case, it was not terribly hard because we had E11, E22, and E12, and we differentiated the third equation with respect to X1 and X2, and we could derive the compatibility condition. Now for the general case, like deriving the three compatibility conditions from these six equations is non-trivial. And we could play with something like this, what we did, but it will take us a while. Okay? And then we don't know whether we will come up with those three conditions or not. So Ganesh is already lost. No? Okay. So here is the a solution of the problem. A solution, I didn't say the solution of the problem. So we are at point P. Let's assume we know everything at point P, which means we know the strain field and we know the displacement at point P. We want to find the displacement at point Q. So how do we do it? So displacement, say UA, this A is the index, A equal to 1, 2, 3. This Q is the point where we were trying to find the displacement. It's minus UA at P. So that should equal the integral of this this differential dUA from P to Q.
Dr. Batra?
Yes?
Could you explain the notation UAQ again?
Okay, sure. So Q is the point. Like this indicates displacement at point Q. A is 1, 2, and 3. That means we are talking about one X component or Y component or Z component of displacement. And this one is basically, if you integrate dx, you get x. So if I integrate dua, if I integrate the differential ua, I should get ua. But this is no sweat, because I should get ua, and then I'm evaluating this at the limits. My limiting points are p and q. Does it make sense? So dua is the differential of displacement ua, like dx. So it's differential of ua, and the differential we can write it as delta ua over delta xb dxb. Okay, this is calculus. Differential of a function is by using the chain rule of calculus, because u is a function of x1, x2, x3. So we differentiate with respect to x1, multiply with dx1, and then differentiate with respect to x2, multiply with dx2. Okay? Now, the definition of EAB is 1 half delta UA over delta XB plus delta UB over delta XA. And the definition of omega AB is 1 half delta UA over delta XB . So this is strain, small strain, and this is small rotation, and I'm putting omega with that wiggle, so it's not W. If you add these two up, what do we get? Add these two up. So this term will cancel with that. Half and half will give us 1. So delta UA over delta XB. So this thing is EAB plus omega AB dxb, and we are integrating from point P to Q. This blob is B. Is it okay? Now, so what we have then is UA at point Q minus UA at point P equals EAB plus omega AB D of XB minus D So I change that D of X to D of X minus X of point Q, the coordinates of point Q. Coordinates of point Q are fixed. So once you have chosen the point Q, its coordinates are fixed. So what is the differential of what is this quantity?
Zero.
So that's why if you subtract zero, it makes no difference. Okay? If you subtract zero, it makes no difference. Of course, I'm not crazy. I have a purpose. That's why I wrote that zero there. And the purpose is the following. So now I take this omega AB, and I want to simplify this term. I want to simplify this term by integrating by parts. So those of you who are in my finite element class or who have taken finite element class before, we do this all the time, right? So let's integrate by parts. So the first function as it is, integral of second, that's xb minus xb cube minus integral of second derivative of first. So it's integration by parts. To remind you, it's a udv equals uv minus vdu. And if you don't remember it, start from here and then integrate. If this one you should remember, because you learned in first year calculus, this is the differential of the product of two functions. So if you remember this, then integrate it and you will get this. That's what we are using. Okay? So if, no, this is between limits P and Q. So this quantity should be between P and Q, and this should be between P and Q. So at the upper limit, so what is this equal to? At the upper limit, this is zero because we will have xbq minus xbq. So this thing will equal then minus omega abp xbp minus xbq. Plus, oh, not plus, but minus this P to Q, XB minus XBQ. This we can write delta omega AB over delta XC DXC. Is it okay? So now let's go back to this definition of omega AB. So omega AB comma C is 1/2 UA comma BC minus UB comma AC. I guess UA comma B minus UB comma A. So it's UA comma BC minus UB comma AC.
Dr. Bhatia?
Yes?
Where is C coming from, or what is the C?
What does comma mean?
The C, like delta XC?
X is the coordinate of a point. C is an index like A, B, or L, or M.
Okay, so it's just a random
index. Yeah, it's just a random, right. It's just a random index, right.
Okay.
It's like A, like random index. Just this C is not anything to do with the Cauchy-Green tensor, and that B has nothing to do with Cauchy-Green tensor. These are indices, just randomly chosen. And if you don't like ABC, you can say L and N. Yes.
The split there where you put the comma between the A and the B, it seems weird. I thought the comma and the differentiation would be between AB comma C and then C comma AB.
No. Look at omega AB. See? Omega AB is UA comma B minus UB comma A. And then we are differentiating both sides with respect to C, XC. So I don't have a choice. I mean, I cannot arbitrarily put indices.
Yeah, I was just if
it was omega J comma smiley face, it would be U smiley or J comma smiley face, and then U smiley face comma J. Followed what it was.
Yeah, see, like it's omega AB was UA comma B minus UB comma A. And then you are differentiating again with respect to C now. Okay, so I'm going to add this UC comma AB and subtract UC comma AB. So basically, I'm adding zero. Right? To the right-hand side, I'm adding 0. But I write 0 as A minus A. This is the same thing as that. So they just cancel, right? And adding 0 doesn't cause any problem, except I have a purpose, of course. So the purpose is that the first term, combine these two, so we have 1/2 UA comma BC plus UC comma B A or AB, doesn't matter. Until I had UC comma AB. So let me rewrite. So I have 1/2 UA comma BC plus UC comma AB minus 1/2 UB comma AC plus UC comma AB. So I'm combining these two terms and I'm combining these two terms. Okay, so now the partial derivatives commute. So I'm going to write this thing as UA comma CB rather than BC. I'm going to interchange B and C. Partial derivatives commute, which means you can differentiate with respect to XC first and then XB. Okay? So if you buy that, then I can write this as 1/2 UA comma B, sorry, UA comma C plus UC comma A differential with respect to B and minus 1/2. And we do the same thing here. So we have UB comma C plus UC comma B comma A. So I'm interchanging the derivative. Instead of saying this is AC, I'm writing it as CA. U become AC is same thing as U become a CA. Because partial derivatives commute. Okay, now. So what is UA comma C plus UC comma A? 1/2 of that? EAC. So this is EAC, B plus EBC, A. Oh, minus B.
And this all still equals omega ABC.
Right. We are not done yet. We are going to go back now. So all of this, this was omega AB comma C, was this, was that. So all of this is omega AB comma C. And that has to go in here. Right? And that has to go in what we were doing is this integral was equal to that, was equal to this, equal to that, so then we evaluate this quantity. So now let's substitute for omega AB comma C here. So what have we found so far? So what we have is, can you see all of it or not? Okay. So here we have omega AB, this thing equal to that, equal to this, and then we have equal to this, and we need to substitute this thing into here. So what is the end result? So we have UAQ minus UAP equals EAB from P to Q DXB. Now I'm not worried about XBQ anymore. Plus, so this is the first term we have here. The second term we worked on, this was the second term, which was equal to this, and then we simplified it, and we have the second term as minus omega ABP XBP minus XBQ minus XB minus XBQ. This delta omega AB over delta XC is this quantity, which is EAC comma B minus EBC comma A DXC. So we have these, this as the final result. Does it make sense? I'm sorry, it's kind of, I cannot write a whole lot on the paper, and so you cannot see the whole thing at one time. I mean, if we had a big chalkboard, then it's possible, but the way we are. So any question about this, what we have done so far? We are almost there now, almost done. I want to combine this term with this one. How should I do? Jessica. Any suggestion? Good. So you change the index of the first, say B and B summed. But we have a DXC here, right? So just change that to C. It's a dummy index, right? So now we can combine these two integrals into one. The other quantity is, they are known, so that's not a causing a problem. So what we have is UAQ equals UAP minus omega ABP XBP minus XBQ plus EAC minus XB minus XBQ EAC comma B minus EBC comma A, all of this DXC. And this is integrated from P to Q. So we are almost there. We have just one more step and we're done. Bless you. So the first part, this part is known. We cannot, I mean, this is evaluated either at point P or at point Q. And let's call this thing as RAC. Because B is summed, so it's only three indices are A and C. So let's call it RAC. Because then I don't have to write the whole thing again and again. Okay? So let's call it RAC. Now let's see, let's go back to where we started. So how many paths are there to go from P to Q? How many ways can I go from P to Q? I could go this way. I could go this way. I could go this way. I could go something like that. Right? So there are infinitely many ways I can go from P to Q. And we want our result to be independent of the path. We want our result to be independent of the path. That really means this integral, which is the only thing that depends upon the path. So the result of this integral should be independent of the path we take. Right? So what is the condition that says this integral is path independent? Calculus again. So what is the, I think you are getting anxious to answer.
Yeah, probably we should find a potential.
We should find the potential. So what is the, well, it's good. What is the condition for the potential to exist? And we have done that in the class. How many of you are in fluid mechanics? How many of you are in solid mechanics? So the rest of you are not studying any, either fluids or solids? So how many of you are studying rigid body dynamics then? I mean, that's the only other thing left, right? So you are. Did we say something like vorticity is zero? Did we define an irrotational flow? Say yes or no. Did we define irrotational flow or not? So what was the irrotational flow? The curl is zero.
Sorry, Professor. Another way could be take into account the exact form.
exact form of, well, this is the exact form. We didn't make any approximations. So far, actually, all throughout today, we did not make any approximation. Everywhere is equality, equality, equality. And the only thing we have used is calculus. We have not used anything from mechanics, basically. We have six partial differential equations, and we are trying to find when will they have a unique solution for the three unknowns. The problem is if we have six equations for three unknowns. If we had six equations for six unknowns, then it will be okay. Then I will not have to spend 50 minutes. So it's the curl of A, curl of R should be zero. So this integral is something like a vector A dotted with D R that so this, for this integral to be path independent, or for this integral to come out to be zero on every closed path, and this is true if and only if curl of A is zero. Okay, this integral is path independent, or the what? 1206. Please, 2-3 more minutes, otherwise we have to start all over again. So curl of A should be 0 means R A C comma D should equal R A B comma C. So this integral will be path independent if R A C comma D equals R A D comma C. Curl, this thing will mean like A I comma J equals A J comma I. So all we are doing is replacing, A is fixed. A is not doing anything. So it's really C comma D equals D comma C. And then just substitute the value of R. Substitute the value of R So if you substitute the value of R, then you get this. And I think one more step, if you... So what will be the derivative of this? What is the derivative? What is delta XB over delta XD? It's Kronecker delta. So if you recall this and carry out this differentiation, the end result is going to be A C comma B D plus E B D comma A C minus A D comma B C minus B C comma A D equal to 0. So this minus is minus here. If you simplify it, which obviously I can't do it in, because I've already kept you over time. But how many equations are here? There are four free indices, A, B, C, and D. So how many equations are there? He said 12. Who said 81? Josh, you are right. There are 81 equations. Out of those 81 equations, 75 are 0 equal to 0. So there are only 6 equations left, which are not 0 equal to 0. Out of these 81, 75 are 0 equal to 0. There are 6 left, which are not zeros, which are not 0 equal to 0. And out of those 6, there are only 3 linearly independent. However, it's a lot easier to remember them in this form than to write those 3, the 6. So next time when we meet on Friday, I will be out of town. I will leave town tomorrow afternoon. Will not have access to the internet. So don't expect a reply back if you send me an email, because I will be in the plane all day afternoon. And then Wednesday, I have a meeting where I'm not supposed to be looking at the internet. And then Thursday, I take the plane back, because I'm going to the West Coast. So there's a 3-hour time difference. And that basically screws things up. Okay? So if you have any questions, you can send me an email today. But nothing after tomorrow, 11 o'clock, when I meet the other class.